Hey, Fitzy.
Yes.
I have a riddle for you before we go live here.
Okay.
Yeah, we've been doing riddles at night with the kids.
Okay.
Hold on, where to go? What is always in front of you, but can't be seen? Always in front of you, but cannot be seen.
Don't know the answer to that.
Kirk, do you have an answer?
Maybe your nose? I guess I can see my nose.
Yeah, yeah. It's the future.
Ah.
Or, yeah, so like our show, for example. We have no idea how this is going to go. It could be a total train wreck. We should have said that. Positive Tuesday is Benefitsy.
It could be a train wreck.
It could absolutely be a train wreck. And that's usually how we like to do it. All right, well, let's kick this thing off. I think we're up. There we go. Good morning, everybody, and happy Thanksgiving. It's Positive Tuesday today, November 23rd, 2021. For Barron County Sheriff Chris Fitzgerald, I'm Ben Dryden, and you're watching Positive Tuesday with Ben and Fitzy, presented by ICAA. ICAA is your local social service organization that works together with individuals, families, and the community to create and support local solutions for local needs. For a full list of services, find them on Facebook or check them out on their website at IndianHeadCAA.org. As you can see, we are being joined by a guest today, one of the best humans on the planet and someone that I am honored to call my very close friend, firefighter and first responder on the St. Croix Falls Fire Department and mayor of the city of St. Croix Falls, Wisconsin, Mr. Kirk Anderson. Kirk is joining us to discuss several things, including the miracle at Big Rock, which I think opens this Friday. Speaking of, we are going to be doing a giveaway today for a family pack of four tickets, so you can experience the miracle at Big Rock. So simply comment with what you are thankful for, in obviously the comment section, in order to be automatically entered for this family pack giveaway. I think it's a $68 value, actually. We'll have more on that in a little bit. But first, let's just kick this thing off. Kirk, good morning. How are you? Thanks for being on, man.
Great. Yeah, no, thanks for having me on. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm a watcher of the show, so it's kind of weird being on this side of the camera.
Yeah, right. Fitzy, good morning.
Morning, how are you?
I'm okay. I'm spending more time at the office in the studio lately. Drusha took some time off of work, like she had vacation time. So she took all this week off and last Friday. So with weekends, it was like 10 days off.
Okay.
And kind of find out, so when I'm at home and I'm working and she's at home doing projects, but if I'm at home, like in her mind, that means I'm available to help projects. So
I hear you,
and she gets me every time with the, you know, because she's taking one room and turning it into a library. So she's painting, and now she wants the, what is that called with the carpets, the cleaning, the steam cleaning thing. You can rent those things.
Yeah.
So she does the, but you know, it's so heavy, and then and you're so big and strong. I'm like, I'll take care of it, you know. And then like halfway through, I'm like, oh, she got me. Women.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's not how it went, but that's okay. Yeah, in your mind, that's okay.
I say she's manipulative. She says persuasive. Whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah. I got my own office with five kids. I got my own office very quickly because there's no way you get anything done at home.
Not with everybody else's home.
Not with five kids, no.
Yeah. So, Fitzy, obviously, it's been a couple of weeks. You were down was it Saturday? It was football. What happened? Friday. I didn't see what happened to the Rice Lake football team.
Well, we lost, but It was pretty. It was an honor to play in at UW-Madison. My kid got to play on the field, take part in the game. Had a great game. They had played a tough team, and our number one guy went out on the third play of the game, fractured his bone and his upper ankle.
Oh.
Talked to him last night. Yeah, so he was out. Tried to go back in, couldn't. Alex is a good friend of my son's and a heck of a football player. It's tough. We lost our number one running back the week before to an injury. We hadn't had injuries all year and lost injuries in the last two. Not an excuse. They played tough, played tough. Defense played. Kolpensky played great as a quarterback. I mean, it was just fun to see a bunch of high school kids playing a Badger on the Badger field.
Yeah.
It was an honor it was fun to watch them. They had a great season, and we're off to hockey tonight. Actually, we got to play hockey tonight, so we took 2 days off, and we're into hockey. We're ready to go.
Jeepers.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah, that's why we don't sign our kids up for anything. Nope. Just stay at home and watch TV. I don't care. I'm not going to these things.
Play on the computer.
Kirk, don't you? You have kids that are involved in stuff, don't you?
Yeah, we had a son. We have a son that was a football player last year. And he suffered a detached retina after practice one day. So he's got his vision back. Surgeons down in the Twin Cities were fantastic. But that precluded him from being a football player, in my mind. And so he's sticking with basketball. So right now I have two kids that are in basketball and three kids that are doing other things. So, yeah, we're busy at our house.
Oh. So, by the way, Fitzy, I forgot, we talked about this 2 weeks ago when we did a giveaway, that I was supposed to be ready for a better system. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not.
I know.
Yeah, I know. See? Low expectations. I love
that's
it.
That's right. That's right.
Oh, so we're somebody, literally going to draw out of a bucket.
Yeah. Shania says, I'm thankful for my family and my husband. Aw, see, that's what we're asking. So here it is, before we get into our stuff, every Tuesday for our Positive Tuesday shows from now until the first episode, I think in January, we're going to be doing a giveaway of a four pack. So I think we have like six shows or five shows. So you get four tickets. Hold on, I wrote this down. I asked the Josh Hansen, who's a part of the Miracle at Big Rock. You can just go to Big Rock, like miracleatbigrock.com. We have some information on our website and dryandwear.com as well. But it's a four pack of adult tickets, a $68 value. So when we select the winner randomly at the end, actually we'll have probably Kirk do that. You will get we'll send you a promo code. This is directly from him in an email. Then they will use that when they go online and pick the night they want to come. So you have to, you know, you have to register on what night you want to go, enter the promo code, and then they're good to go. It's good for four adult tickets each. Well, four, you know, adult tickets. If they use the adult ticket for a kid, no big deal. If they need extra tickets, the code would just take $68 off of their order. So there you go. That's what it is.
And that's nice. Why we brought Kirk on to tell us more about this, because it's in his area. And that was what, besides he's got some amazing background and some other things, but we really wanted to bring Kirk on to tell us more about St. Croix Falls and this wonderful event. And now they're a sponsor and they want to give away, and it looks pretty fabulous.
Yeah.
So can you tell us about it, Kirk?
Yeah, and just, I'm sorry, real quick, I forgot. I don't know if I think I put it on like the description on our thing, but in order to have a chance to enter, please comment with something that you are thankful for during this Thanksgiving. Sorry, Kirk, go ahead.
Yeah, well, thanks again for having me on. And today's really exciting. Tomorrow will be kind of the pre- lighting festival. It's not official, but they're going to do the pre tour, and I'll get a chance to go through and see the Big Rock, Miracle at Big Rock. Basically, what we're looking at is just a couple miles north of St. Croix Falls, which is really exciting for us because as the mayor promoting tourism, we're going to, you know, hopefully see tens of thousands of people over the next couple months go through our downtown.
What?
And that's a very unique opportunity. So Big Rock Creek, the folks over there have partnered with our businesses to promote this and to basically leverage their traffic for our benefit. And so our downtown's looking fantastic. We've got lights up and very festive. But what we're looking at for Big Rock's event is over a mile long tour with 12 different themes and activities. They'll have singing Christmas trees. They'll have sleigh rides and hay rides.
Wait, hold on. Wait. Singing Christmas trees?
Hey, Ben, we can't give away all our secrets.
That's a
thing?
Yeah,
I can't. It's, well, yep. There's a when you invest in an event, you can come up with some pretty unique ideas. So there'll be some singing Christmas trees there. They're going to have a helicopter ride that you can go and check the lights out from above if you'd like to take part in that. They'll have evening private tent rentals for families and for date nights.
Oh, I see.
Date nights. This could be fun. And then they're going to have an entire area set up for shopping with local vendors. So they've partnered with local vendors and bringing their wares in to help promote local business. And we really appreciate that. And that's over 8,000 square feet in a heated space. And then we all love food trucks. They're going to have a bunch of different food trucks to feed everyone. Mm. They'll have fire pits and s'mores. They'll have an 80-foot Christmas tree. It's the tallest wrapped Christmas tree in the upper Midwest. There'll be free decorating of cookies for the kids, free wine tasting, and free parking. And this is located just north of St. Croix Falls on Highway 87, and it's Big Rock Creek. The website is bigrockcreekwi.com. So that's the promo stuff that I got from them. I've been to this venue a number of times. My niece was married there. I've actually camped there when they were building it and had a chance to go on what was about, I think, 1,500 privately owned acres. Now this family's purchased a smaller portion of that, but they have trails that go through this whole property that the that they're going to have set up for the lights. It's going to be a fantastic show. They're
sorry, hold on. I thought that, by the way, I thought it said Thankful for a Shepherd and the THC.
That would be Ben.
Yeah. Right, Ben. So not me. Not me. The other Ben. Right. Sorry, Kirk. I said that was kind of funny. I'm like, wait, what did I just put up on the screen?
Yeah, would you?
There's that one guy.
Yeah, there's always one.
So yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. And it's a unique experience that they're comparing to going head to head with other beautiful lighting shows. There's one in Somerset that is real popular and one up in Duluth that's real popular. And so this will be right up in that same, even bigger. Somerset's got a very small footprint in comparison to the 1 mile trail. So it'll be really interesting. And everybody's really excited about it.
And so how did you, cause you're not like an actual part of the, I don't know what it's called, the organizers. I'm sorry. I assumed that you're not actually sure on that. And if you are, that's fine. But how do, as the mayor in St. Croix Falls, what role do you play in this? Is it the promoter part? Is this good for the city? Or is this one of those, again, being a first responder and being a supporter of law enforcement, knowing a lot of people in law enforcement, is this also a, oh boy, you know, it's like having a big concert come to town. Right. We're going to have a bunch of problems. Now, I wouldn't think so. I mean, it's, you know, it's a Christmas thing.
Yeah, this is going to be a huge event for the area. And so one of the great things that Big Rock Creek's two families did was invite local stakeholders. So it's not technically in the city. It's just outside of the city limits in St. Croix Falls, so in the township. So they invited Sheriff Walk and his chief deputy to come and talk about safety and traffic. They invited the mayor and city administrator, the township chairman for the township, as well as all of the people who promote the area, the local marketing, Chamber of Commerce, the Polk County Economic Development Corporation, all to sit down in a room, get all the ideas out and say, how can we partner? And they've done that really well. So all those individuals have bought into this and are very excited to have them do this. Highway 87 is a single lane, sometimes double lane highway. And so there are some concerns about traffic, and they've worked with the Sheriff's Department to make sure that that's going to be a safe place for everyone. And so it's partnerships. They've done a great job with partnerships.
That's awesome. I'm excited to go myself. I plan on getting out there and going to it. And that's the draw. I mean, that's the draw. I mean, it's, you know, I don't have a reason to go to St. Croix Falls, but now there's a reason to go to St. Croix Falls. That's your job as the mayor, and we understand.
You're welcome here anytime.
Yeah, I appreciate it.
Bring money. Yeah.
Bring the money. Yeah. Bring the money. Yeah. But that's how it works. I mean, that's how the tax revenue helps the county, which helps municipalities, which is a big part of the process. But beyond that, it's just going to be pretty neat. It's a neat event that we don't, you know, unless we go to Duluth, you don't see that around the area. So it's something like that in Northwest Wisconsin is what we need to do and draw people in. And it's just going to be fun and peaceful and neat. And Who doesn't like food trucks? I mean, yep. I love food trucks.
Right, and singing trees in private tents for dates. I mean, this sounds fantastic.
Yeah,
and it sounds like, I mean, I've heard, and I don't think, well, they're not the ones that told me, but I have heard tell that this was over a easily clear of $1 million of money put into this. Now, I don't know how accurate that is. We like spreading rumors as much as we possibly can. But regardless, but it's a ton they're doing. And this isn't like, well, it's for kind of St. Croix Falls and... Or if you live in Polk County and it's not too far. This is going to be bringing in people from everywhere, the Twin Cities and all over Wisconsin. This isn't some little, it'll be kind of cute. It'll be kind of nice. This is like gigantic.
Yeah. There's people that travel up to Duluth from all over the state to go to Bentleyville. This will rival that and if not surpass it. And again, it's really the footprint, we just stayed in Duluth for an overnight, and we're down next to the aquarium where the Bentleyville is, and they were setting it up, and I was amazed at how big but also how small it was. It's just in the parking lot area right off the highway, and this is an entire 1,500-acre piece of property. They don't own that much of it. They own several hundred acres, and they've really...
And there you go. Kirk. That's fine. Yeah, way to go, Kirk. Just click the, click the button. And Fitzy, there was a question. Oh, never mind. Guest in green room. Yes.
Did you do it?
One. I didn't do it. There he is.
Oh, sorry about that.
Okay.
Yeah. So one of their parking lots that they created is a 40-acre parking lot. They took 40 acres just for their parking lot.
What?
And so that's a lot of dirt to move.
40 acres. And, it's bigger than the hometown I grew up in.
Yeah. So this is going to be a big deal. And hopefully it will go over really well.
All right. There's a question for both of you. First, for Kirk. I believe Kirk is. Oh, Fitch and I don't know. Is Haley's Comet Coffee shop still there?
There is not a Haley's Comet coffee shop in St. Croix Falls. There's a Three Arrows coffee shop that's been here for several years, and it's fantastic.
Okay.
Speaking of coffee, I didn't get my mug.
Are you plugging something?
No. Oh, well, okay. I didn't get my mug, so I had to have dry and wire written on my cup. So I need my bling.
Okay, fine, jeepers. Fitzy, I don't know if you had seen a question in there. I'm trying to find it now. I don't know if you have your questions or comments.
I have them. From Larry Olson?
Yeah, maybe that was it. Sorry, I'm trying to find it so I can put it on the screen, but I don't know where it went.
The missing persons?
Yeah. Larry. There it is. I just want to put that up. Can we get a list of all missing persons in Barron County?
Well, we don't have any missing persons in Barron County, but I did see that one of the counties or one of the missing person agencies put all the missing people in Northwest Wisconsin and said, you know, hunters, be aware of it. So I remember seeing that on Facebook, but I don't know who put it out. I can look for that, maybe share it on our Facebook page. But anytime any hunters come across anything suspicious, they should, you know, report it. Don't pick it up. Don't collect it. If you think it's suspicious or part of a crime or something odd, you know, just leave it. Let us come and look at it. Maybe it's nothing. Let us pick it up. Collect it the way it should be collected. Report anything suspicious at any time to us, and we'll take care of it. But I think you know, there's a missing person from Burnett County, and then the Washburn County case, and I think there was another one somewhere else. So I think that person put a map together, area. So that's what I think Larry's referencing, and I think that was a cool thing to do. Sure. But anytime, report anything suspicious. We had a very safe hunting weekend so far. I don't know how many deer were harvested or anything like that, but I worked Saturday morning for a while. Very quiet Saturday morning. I've been working patrol a lot this week because there's not a lot of meetings going on, so it's been kind of nice. But just regular stuff going on, nothing real major going on. So it's been a good, safe opening weekend of hunting.
Good. And speaking of, so we'll get back to some Miracle Rig, Big Rock in a little bit, but we always like to go through press releases or articles. So we've been off for a couple of weeks, so we can kind of go through this a little more quickly. Oh, Mike. I think he's talking about that bling there, Kirk. Yeah, you're not getting a mug from us anytime soon. Boy, that guy's, he's killing me here.
He has a gun. Yeah.
He's just killing me.
Before you do that, Ben, sure. I'll just say, in Polk County, we do have a missing person that's been missing for over 10 years. Rose Bly.
Yeah.
Is a St. Croix native. She went missing in Barron County. Her car was found up in Grantsburg. I had the privilege of doing a video documentary for the Polk County Sheriff's Department.
Yeah.
And that's reemerged recently with actually her niece in Tennessee is missing. And they're trying to see if there's any ties to that the case locally. So we always ask for people to be looking for anything suspicious in the woods during hunting
season. I know, and I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but I don't really believe in coincidences. It's just really interesting. That's all. I think I'll just leave that there. So because it's been a couple weeks, I have had a few articles down regarding Barron County law enforcement. And actually, Kirk, I wanted to get your take on one that was just in Polk County yesterday as well. But the headline, I think we did this on the 10th, was this was regarding a Muhammad Shayir, I believe is how you pronounce it. Court issues nationwide arrest warrant for man charged with homicide by OWI. Anything you want to add to that, Fitzy? Any updates on that?
No, obviously, if anybody has any contact with him, we had received information that he's out of the country. I'm not 100% sure I believe that. And so if he's around, we'll catch him and we'll bring him back to jail here. So if anybody knows where he is, report that to us. But some tips we have gotten, and that's why that warrant was issued. His attorney showed up and said, we don't believe he's in the country. Not 100% sure I believe that yet, but we'll see what happens.
Kevin, I'd ask a question. Do you have to be present? No, as long as you're commenting, so that's fine. So, yeah, everybody, you can just stop watching. Seriously, just stop watching.
Make and a comment and go.
Right. But we'll have to redeem these by like noon. How about that? So we'll send you, whenever we pick the winner, or when we pick the winner at the end of the show, then we will notify you, and you've got till noon to redeem them. Otherwise, then we'll just have to go through and pick somebody else.
We'll keep it ourselves.
We'll just keep it. The three of us will just go. That'd be fantastic. So the other one, I think this was on the 16th, driver. Oh, shoot. This was the sub-headline, not the actual headline. But the sub-headline was driver struck building because he was upset by Cumberland police officer issuing a citation to his family member. It was the, I can't remember what the headline was now, that it ran into the city hall / police department.
I get angry when I get pulled over too, but I've never done that.
Yeah, well, it wasn't even him; it was a family. Anyway, I know that was a Cumberland situation, the municipality there. But is there anything that you wanted to add to that story?
No, I mean, like Kirk said, you get mad, but you don't. It doesn't make a lot of sense, but that's what alcohol does. He was obviously intoxicated, or allegedly. I have to say, allegedly intoxicated, and you know, alcohol is a contributing factor to that, and it's pretty obvious that it was, and just don't drink and drive like we've talked about.
Wait, why do you have to say allegedly and then say alcohol is believed to be a factor? So was alcohol a factor, or wasn't it? And if it was a factor, then
alcohol is a factor, but I can't say that he was intoxicated because those results aren't back yet.
Got it. So, oh, boy.
But he was charged with, I believe, OWI and something else.
All right. Our third one.
$100,000 in damage.
Yeah, I mean, that's just, seriously.
I mean, for a $200 ticket.
I know. It just didn't make any, that didn't really make any sense. But do you get one entry for each thankful comment? Probably.
That's a good question.
Probably. I don't know. We really need to do this better.
Come on, Liz. I know you're thankful for a lot of things.
Don't spam it. Yeah, no. It's very easy to do. So here's the next one. This was on the 18th. This was I don't know how to pronounce the first name. Maybe it's Kyle, and it's just K-E-I-L, going. Man sentenced on fleeing conviction, restitution ordered for squad car damages.
Correct. He was in a chase. And smashed into one of my squad cars and one of the Shtek Police Department squad cars. He'll be paying for those damages. And he got, I think, 80 days in jail or 87 days in jail. And
I don't know. You happy with that one? I mean, know what I mean? I mean, law enforcement, unless they're, you know, there's always going to be, well, I would have liked to see more. Is this one like, well, maybe a little more, but for the most part, it's fine.
I think this was probably a pretty good happy medium for everybody. You know, I'm more concerned about it not costing the taxpayers money out of my budget.
Oh, right.
To reduce that. So if he pays that restitution back, that's the most important thing. We don't see a lot of restitution for any of our victims. I mean, it's just something that doesn't happen a lot because, you know, that's the least part of any worry. Yeah.
Do you find it's difficult to get new cars when they're damaged? Or we recently hit a deer with one of our squad cars, and finding that replacement was extremely dangerous. So I tell my officers, don't hit anything.
right.
Yeah. We have a, I think I have a hookup for you if you need to. We're ordering in bulk.
I'll juice you up, man.
We're trying to order in bulk.
We'll get on the
our dealerships because of just for that reason. We have a local dealership that's as long as they get the low bid, but they do have some extras on hand, or hopefully we'll have extras on hand shortly for just that situation for law enforcement officers, because you're exactly right. It's impossible. You have or just getting parts to fix the cars. It's taking six weeks, 8 weeks, and your car's out of commission. Now, I'm lucky enough. I have 17, 18 squad cars. You probably have 4 or 5 in St. Croix Falls.
Yeah, four.
And so if two of them go down or one's out of commission and one's, it becomes very difficult. We've had municipalities use some of our squad cars when they've been down. Some of our municipalities only have two. And if one's broken down and one hits a deer, then, you know, we'll help them out. Hey. Use one of our squads. So,
Well, it's difficult to find for sure. And right now repairs, I'm trying to get my brakes repaired and, they're trying to find parts. So it's a big issue.
Yeah. And I can't get, I need to update my glasses and I can't get in for like 3 months. I missed a dentist appointment, just like a regular cleaning. And it was one morning and it was like an hour before, it was last week. And something came up. I mean, I can't predict the news, and something came up. I'm like, yep, gonna have to reschedule. And they said, okay, how's May look? Like May. I don't even know what I'm doing tomorrow. So, but they're 6 months out. That's ridiculous. Yeah. All right. So here's the last one. There was, we did this on the 19th, so it must have been last Friday. This is regarding Jack Kurchinski. Headline was, man sentenced on OWI sixth conviction from single vehicle crash incident. I think it was 6 years total, 3 years in prison, 3 years probation. Anything you want to add there, Fitzy?
We need to start doing something about these OWIs in the sixth. If he got 3 years in, that's pretty good. I'll take that because I've seen a lot less. So, I think what's going to, I love that. They have a 2002 Impala for sale.
Fantastic.
Now we're Facebook Marketplace all of a sudden. They'll be selling their stuff on DrivingWire. That's awesome.
Tires and a cup engine.
Right. Yeah. I think what's going to come out of things like a bond. I mean, we've struggled with bonds. We've talked about bonds. I think what happened in Waukesha is a tragedy, but I think people are going to be looking at the bonds of why this guy was out of jail. Why are people out of jail? It's interesting.
Yeah.
We have one going in front of a judge today at 1 o'clock. That'll be very interesting. I can't comment on it right now, but
something happened.
He hasn't been charged yet. So,
fine. Okay, we'll talk about it next Tuesday.
It's somebody that's in jail for homicide, and he violated his bond, and he had bonded himself out of a high cash bond.
Okay.
And I'm curious to see what happens.
Oh, sure.
With that bond, are they going to take that bond? We've never taken bonds in Barron County. And so are we going to let him back out? We going to give him another high cash bond? So, it's a homicide charge. I mean, it's the most serious crime you can have. Right. And so it'll be very interesting what happens this afternoon. And I think people, tragedy brings out good, and there has to be some good that happened in Waukesha. And what's going to come out of this is bonds that people get are going to be looked at. Finally, we've been begging for this.
Yeah.
And we need to look at the bond system in Wisconsin. And I don't know that it's all over the board, and we need to have a better system.
A little more consistency.
It's got to be better for some of these people to get out of jail.
Hey, how does that work? And I don't know, maybe Kirk, you know this too, but Is there, you know, some crimes you could be charged with something, a minimum or a maximum of something. There's kind of this ballpark area, you know, could yeah. face up to 10 years and up to $30,000. Is there one of those? Do bonds work that way? We should get John Yackel back on, Judge Yackel in Sawyer County, and ask him that, because he's come on and talked about bonds before. But is there a, for this kind of a case, whether it's a misdemeanor or so many things, because I know there's a lot of factors. I mean, there's a ton of factors that go into these things. That's why it's not just as easy as they were charged with this or charged with allegedly doing this, and then here's the bond. There's a lot of factors that go into it. But is there a minimum? Like, okay, it's got to have at least this if it's this kind of a crime or what they're being charged with. Is that how it works?
Is that, and is there something to do with space in the jail and maybe COVID that has made it easier for people to be released? But it always floors me when I hear that someone who assaulted somebody or a sexual assault or something like that gets out with a signature bond. And that's the recurring frustration that I see online when people see these cases, you know, your 13th OWI, how is that person not in jail? And we had one of the chief deputies for Polk County was speaking at a Rotary Club. And that was what everybody's question was, is how come these people who are out on their 11th, 12th OWI aren't in jail? And there wasn't a real definitive answer. I don't know if you have something on that, but...
Bond is to make sure you come back to court. That's right. What our judges always say.
Yep.
But they're also, bond also means to protect the public. You're out on bond. And I'm all for, I'm okay with the OWI first offense in Wisconsin. It's a traffic ticket. You learn from it. People make mistakes. We can move beyond, you know, people make mistakes. But when it's your fourth offense bond violation, it's time to put the hammer down. And because you obviously have told the judge three different times, I don't really care what you say, judge. I mean, if they could word it that way, the judge would give them a higher bond. But they're right. Like, well, judge, I made a mistake. I didn't mean to smoke meth again for my third time. It just happened. You know, it's very frustrating from a law enforcement. And I'm glad Kirk said that, because that's the kind of thing that, and it looks like the cops aren't doing their job. And the cops get beat up for that. And I'm not taking that stance anymore. And I haven't for the last year. But it's very frustrating. And people need to stand up, and we need to do something. And sadly, the Waukesha thing is, I think, going to come out, because the Milwaukee DA's office said, guys shouldn't have been on a $1,000 cash bond. I don't know what happened. I can tell you our DA's office has asked for hundreds, $200,000 cash bonds, and it gets reduced in half because the guy has no criminal record or he showed up for all of his court dates. I don't care. He just assaulted somebody. He just did this. He just sold meth to a kid. I don't know what it was, but it's frustrating, and I think it's finally going to come out, and it's not going to be fun.
It's a reform issue too. The DA in Milwaukee ran on lowering the bond rates and lowering the number of people that are in jail. So he's going to be walking back some of those words that he gave in his election to get elected as the DA. And I think that's, you know, I'm all for reform and helping people get through things. If you're a meth addict, I don't, you know, write you off. I want you to get help. Right. But there's also something to protecting the public and you know, keeping those people off. Because when you're drunk driving, you're putting my 17-year-old and my 15-year-old who's got a permit on in the zone, you know, for their danger. And so I would rather you not be on, but get help. Just don't do it on the streets.
Yeah. We had a story that we did there was like a string of three straight weeks. It was Sawyer County Judge. I think all three were Judge Yackel, where there were three different cases. So none of them related, but it was about, I think they were all older, you know, men, and it had to do with, you know, minor children, sex, porn stuff, you know, gross stuff. And all three had $250,000 cash bonds. So that was huge, at least I thought. I mean, that's I love seeing that stuff. But the interesting thing was, one of them, the guy is also being charged with a similar crime, or at least this one is also known because it's in the system, in another county, like Monroe, and the guy gives him a $5,000 cash bond. It's like, what? That's what we can't have. We can't have $5,000 in one county or from one judge, like in Barron and in Polk. You guys have like three different judges. But in Washburn, yeah. Burnett, and Sawyer, and Russ, we got one judge. But regardless, you can't have that much of a discrepancy. That's ridiculous.
I think what the judges have concentrated on coming back to court, making sure people show up for court, because that's the legal definition of a bond. But I also think there's part of that bond is protecting the public. And I think sometimes we think we're in small town Wisconsin and nothing bad happens here. But right. I think we have to take that and say, you know what, that's a little bit bigger than coming back to court, yeah. Protecting the public. And so I think that trend will come. At least I hope it comes. And again, you got to take the bad things and make good out of them. And that's what I'm going to do, because I think it's, you know, it's tragic what happened, and I don't think it was intentional. I think the guy was probably fleeing from something. I don't know.
Sounds like
a thousand news stories out there. You don't know what to believe. Yeah. We'll believe it when the sheriff says or the police chief says it. Yeah. But that was just my soapbox, and that's where I think some good's got to come out of this, and maybe we'll get some good that comes out of it.
Yeah, and it was like the grannies, wasn't it? Like the dancing grannies? I mean, I'm just
yeah.
like anyone that dies is bad. It's not like that makes it worse.
Five that died were part of that troop. Yeah.
Right. And I mean, it's not like, well, you know, if they just, you know, if that person hit the, what are those ones called? They got the little tiny motorcycles and they go in parades. And what are those called? Those, that group?
The Mason.
Shriners, there you go. Yeah. Shriners. As a kid, those things freaked me out when I was a kid. I hated those things. I used to cry when they were in the parade. I don't know why. But I'm just saying, it's not like they hit them like, oh, it's not a big deal, but if they hit the grannies, then that's worse. Anyone that dies is horrible. But at the same time, it is kind of worse. I mean, yeah. come on, man.
The yeah. Well, they also, that's just horrible. He mowed through, you know, bands.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of kids and Shriners. Things like that, too. So. Yeah. You know, I think the conditions that are put on the bond too can make a big difference whether or not you stick with it. If you break your conditions, that will elevate your revoke your bond, but also elevate your the charges. And
I never, you know, that's a part of this that we really haven't discussed much. But I think you're onto something there. And then the follow up to that is who's monitoring that? I don't know. So well, I want to get to this.
Anyway, before
we get to our giveaway, we had so much more we want to talk about here, but there was another one, and this is in Polk. So, Chris, I don't know if you know anything about this or aware mm-hmm. of anything, but because, Kirk, you are kind of a part of all of this in terms of not just being the mayor but first responder, et cetera, we put up a post as a press release from the Polk County Sheriff's Office yesterday. Their headline was Single Vehicle Crash Results in Death of a 16-year-old, I believe it was a girl.
Yeah.
We put up an obituary last night. We haven't received the official name of the individual that had died. Obviously, we believe we know who that is. There was an obituary that we put on our website last night that, I mean, unless there was another 16-year-old that, you know.
Yeah, no, the families,
it was just
the families put
situation.
It out there.
Okay. And if I was reading it correctly, the obituary, it sounded like she was expecting mother.
Yeah, yeah. So last night at the city council meeting where I'm the mayor in St. Croix Falls, and I took a moment to just acknowledge and pay our respects to this individual and also to the folks in Waukesha because of the tragedy, and just acknowledge that, you know, the governor asked us to lower our flags in honor of them. But St. Croix Falls has seen this in the past, and it just as a father of a 17-year-old and a 15-year-old, it hits hard home. But also as a mayor, you know, I get the privilege of reaching out to some of these folks. But in our history, we had a Clayton, Wisconsin high school student that was killed, two of them that were killed in September of 2019, shortly after. A St. Croix Falls student who was 17 was in a rollover accident that I was on scene for that and held her up as we cut her out of the car. She lost two legs. And then in 2020, in February 21st, we lost two students that were driving to school, 16 and 15. And then, of course, the Amory Senior High School student. Her name was Sierra Osborne. She was expecting. She was 16. These are my kids. You know, this is really tough for me. Her boyfriend was driving. His name is Tyler Melton. And it sounds like possibly there was a deer that they tried to avoid and rolled the F-350. That's a big truck.
Yeah, it is.
You know, it goes to talk about wearing your seatbelt and taking those extra steps to protect yourself because it saves lives. But got to pay my respects to that family and say how sorry we are as a community for Amory and our schools in Polk County. We rally around each other. We wear each other's colors when these types of things happen. So,
well, and Fitzy, you've talked about that often because unfortunately we have had this conversation regarding Barron County. And by the way, Kirk, I remember all those. It was like almost like this stretch of like 6 months or a 9 month period where I was like, what? This is that usually doesn't happen at all, or like randomly once every 5 years. And there were several in a very short amount of time, if I'm recalling. Fitzy, you and I have had to talk about this in the past.
Right.
Go ahead.
It's just sad, and it's tough when you have, I agree, I have a 16-year-old driver and a 19-year-old daughter, and it just sucks. And again, that goes back to what you do, Kirk, on the side. As a fireman and a first responder, we can't do our jobs in law enforcement without you guys and gals being our volunteer firefighters. And, you know, it's tougher and tougher to find volunteer firefighters and EMTs and things like that. And I just thank God there's all of you guys out there and gals out there, because it's so important to have those volunteer firefighters. I mean, they are priceless in counties like Polk and Barron. I mean, they are priceless. I'm thankful for all of them, because they're all going to get off out of their Thanksgiving dinner if something bad happens, and they're going to go out and help whoever needs it.
Yeah. And I have to say, we look at people who wear a uniform and we think that they are extra special, that they don't, you know, suffer from the same worries. And, you know, we're all human. And so when I look at the calls that I've been on, particularly the two students in St. Croix Falls that died February 2020, that was traumatic for everybody on scene. We knew those kids. We sat next to them in basketball games and football games, watching them on the field. Those kids impacted our community. And as a fire department, experienced a brokenness that, we don't like to talk about, and we don't put it out there, but law enforcement officers aren't above that. The state patrol, the first responders, the people who aren't trained that stop. And there were people that stopped at this accident on Sunday night and rendered aid. Those people are not going to forget that. And even in Waukesha, where you've got professional firefighters,
right,
those folks, they don't see that kind of carnage all the time. So they're walking into it, maybe that's their first mass casualty incident, and they're probably struggling with some mental health and some, you know, things that they can't sleep at night. Got to get help, because so many firefighters and first responders and law enforcement officers are taking their own life, and there is help out there. Talking it out is such a big deal, so get help.
Yeah, and it seems to have this, or at least me looking from the outside, not being law enforcement, but as you both know, all my family, except for my mom and I, have been in law enforcement, and my extended family's in law enforcement. I know a lot of people in law enforcement, but it still has this, I don't know if stigma, that may be the wrong word. No, not stigma. It still has this, I'm a cop, I'm a first responder, I'm a man. And even if you are a female in that position, it's still that toughness, there's something there still. Where hopefully, I don't know, maybe you guys can kind of shed some light on that. Are we getting kind of past that? Is it a position now where it's okay to say, I think I need to talk to someone? Like, as people come to you, Fitzy and Kirk, that you have seen that, it's okay now, where maybe 10 years ago, no, nobody did. You just went home, you drank, and that's it. Like, that's how you deal with it.
Right. Holly Hakes is our specialist, and she is our Hakes Wellness Solutions.
Nice.
I mean, I have that card on my desk. I mean, she's been a trooper with us for all our major incidents. I mean, we get beat up, and every, you know, lost kid, every fatality, every major crash, she comes and debriefs our people. We include our fire departments in those debriefs, and we include our dispatchers, we include our ambulance people, our helicopter people, because it takes its toll. When it could be your fourth fatality this week. I mean, we could, you know, luckily, knock on wood, we haven't had one, but you know, but you could have them bam, bam, bam like that, or have two 16-year-old kids that you watch on that affects you. I don't care how tough you think you are, it affects you. And we talk about it, and I think it's important. Yeah, I think we're beyond the fact that I'm just going to go get drunk tonight instead of talking about it, because it'll make me feel better.
Yeah, and let's face it, I don't want to get into that. But there have been, in the past, we'll say, also a history of some of the, in law enforcement, again, we'll say in the past, and maybe not even our area, but there is still that stereotype of then going home and then drinking and then, you know, beating somebody up. And that's not good. I just hope that we're kind of past all of that. I mean, in terms of just do they feel comfortable? And I think that really comes down to the leadership is it the Burnett County Sheriff Tracy Finch, who you both know, I have just the utmost respect for her, creating that culture. Are people comfortable to be able to go and go to their boss? Or in this case, for you, Fitzy, going to you and say, I need some time. And you go, and well, you know, we're already two people down, another one's out and they're hunting, and there's two vacations, and I just don't have, or is it no problem?
Yeah, it's no problem. It's what we do to take care of your team, because otherwise you're not going to have a team, and then a leader can't be without a team. So,
And a positive behind all of this, actually, because we always try to find something positive here, right, is that even though this was in in Polk County, this incident that we reported on yesterday, I think it was from the day before, of that 16-year-old that's dying, look how many people are rallying to support. And not just the people just in that town. You know, you can do a big city in Chicago. It's, there's so many people. This stuff happens a lot more often. But in a smaller area, it's not just that town. It's Northwest Wisconsin and even further. We're all, what do you need? What can I do? How can I help? So at least from the positive side, that from the families that are left of both the person that is deceased and, of course, the person that was driving, that's you got to live with that rest of your life. I can't imagine what that's like. But that is something positive and something wonderful, again, about our communities, right?
Yeah, I think you know, being one of the senior guys on my fire department, I joined later in life, and so I have a little bit more life experience. I have some experience in counseling and in some ministry aspects of things. I reach out to people who are on those calls with me. We have a chaplain on our department, and people can call him at any time. The county has a fantastic resource for those debriefs, where we're able to sit down all together, everybody who is on scene, and talk about it, get it off your chest. But it's a unique opportunity, but it's also in today's day and age where you can look on Facebook and see who that person was. It used to be years ago that you wouldn't see that. You would be able to walk away, and now you can look them up on Facebook, and you have to not do that if it's going to bother you, but you can see their, you know, how it's affected their family. You can see that maybe they had kids or that they were a mother, and those are the things that kind of haunt you. And so you got to find a way to talk through it and make it a healing, get catharsis on it and be able to say there's closure. But for a lot of people, it's very difficult to let that stuff go.
We're already up against it. We're actually a little bit going long here today. So let's do a giveaway. Fitzy, do you have your...
Wait, I want to ask Kurt one more question. What's new in St. Croix Falls? What's the...
Oh.
Besides... we got to talk more about St. Croix Falls.
Fine.
Yeah.
See you.
Well, besides the Big Rock Creek event that's going to be happening, we have a lot of really cool things that are happening inside of St. Croix Falls. This fall, we've developed a new trail along the river that is going to hopefully be completed here, even as the snow starts to fly. They're putting the final touches on things, but we have Interstate Park, which is the first national park in St. Croix Falls, and then in Taylor's Falls. So it's a unique park, beautiful river right on the St. Croix. Ooh. And we have a trail that goes from the park all the way up to the National Park Service, a couple miles north, that you can walk along the parkway. They overlook this coming December 4th, we're going to have our Christmas in conjunction with what's going on at Big Rock Creek. We're going to have a big Christmas event on what we call the Overlook. It's the Deputy Michael Severson Memorial Park. He was a Polk County officer that was shot back in 1991, and he died of his injuries. We'll have fireworks and Christmas caroling and a big fire out there to enjoy, and then they'll be shopping. So there's a lot of neat stuff. But I didn't give my positive. You skipped the positive part. I went hunting with my 7-year-old, my 10-year-old, and my 17-year-old, and we got 2 deer.
Nice.
On opening morning.
Yeah, it's nice teaching kids when they're young how to kill stuff. That's fantastic.
Well, I know I know Ted Nugent tried to get you to go hunting, and now's the time, Ben. Yeah, if you want to come out to Polk County, I'll let you sit in a stand with me, and we can shoot stuff together.
No, duck hunt on Nintendo is the closest I get to hunting. Yeah, no.
I love duck hunt.
Yeah, that was a great game. Fitzy, do you have your Rolly thing here?
I got my randomizer. I counted them. We're about 50, 55 comments in, I would say. So I'll just put 55 and we'll hit it.
Okay, and then
Hitting from the top or the bottom?
Well, you roll it. I'll decide from top or bottom, and then Kirk will do the counting.
35.
35. I'm going to have to pass on it because my browser shut down, and so all the comments reset. So I might have to have Fitz do the – because I only have half the comments.
Yeah, so everybody else, you can stop commenting. You don't have to say anything nice anymore, or anything that you're thankful for, because now you don't have a chance to win. So now you can say all the negative stuff that you really wanted to say.
Well, I will say, if you're hunting, if you have the pleasure of hunting with a 7-year-old and you get a deer, it is very lucky, because that kid does not stop talking the entire time.
That's awesome.
So I count 35. Yep, sure. I count Larry Olson.
Larry Olson.
Larry Olson.
Larry Olson.
All right, Larry. So they haven't even sent us. They're sending it today. Those codes. So when they send it to us, we will send it to you via your Facebook Messenger of a code, and then you just go to Big Rock. And we'll put the email address in there too, or the website. You just go there and pick a date and put in a code. So we'll send that to you again. That's for 4 tickets, a $68 value. I don't know if you can just take those tickets and maybe just give some of them away for yourself, like a neighbor. I'm not sure how it works. I've never done it. So, yeah, perfect. Hey, real quick, I forgot to bring this up. Fitzy, I thought about you last weekend. Yeah, you bet. I mean, I always think about you. I wake up just Fitzy. That's all I think about. The kids, you know, because they always ask the questions that parents or grown-ups don't, because they're just a lot of times simple questions. And then you can't really answer them. And it was actually, speaking of Waukesha, it was the Rittenhouse verdict. And I didn't watch a minute of that. I have no idea. Well, I assume, really? I believe, it's just my opinion, that the overwhelming majority of time, juries get it right. Correct. Based on what's presented. That's what I think. That's my opinion. I don't know if there's data to back it up. I assume so. But whatever. I mean, there's some that are maybe not. And there's appellate court for that. But I think overwhelming majority of time, they get it right. So I just assumed that with the verdict they came up with was, okay, that was the one that, all right, that was probably the right one. But we were watching the news in the morning, and Rally, one of my daughters, she had said, so he wasn't a cop. I'm like, no, he's just, you know, some dude, right, at this protest. And she goes, but why'd he take a gun? I'm like, yeah, that's weird. And I thought about you, Fitzy, because Jerusha brought up then, well, isn't that what you and Chris had talked about before, that nothing good happens at a bar after 10 o'clock at night or midnight or something like that, right? If bad things are going to happen, it's going to be around drunk people, drunk strangers in an enclosed environment whenever, you know, after midnight, you know, when it's dark. And it was kind of another one of those, and again, I'm not trying to put light on that, but a little bit, a little levity, that, you know, I don't know, if you don't want bad things to happen, maybe don't take guns to riots. I'm just saying. And I'm not talking about the people that died. That's a horrific and a terrible thing. But it's just, what are you doing? Like, if there was a riot, I just wouldn't go to it. Like, I would avoid it. I would go to a hotel 2 counties away for like 3 days. I don't want to be around this, much less go to it, much less bring a gun. Kirk, I know you're, you know, guns cool. Would you go to that with a gun?
Personally, I probably would not have gone to that. If it was in St. Croix Falls, I think that would probably have changed, you know, changed the way things are. But, you know, to the jury, I think juries, we have the most amazing system in the world for trying cases, and the jury, the way that they present the case, and you have the opportunity to present both sides, and a jury of your peers does that. That is very unique to our system and very fair. And so I think that it was 100% the tale of two different stories. If you watch the media's reporting on it versus actually watching the trial, you'll get two completely different stories.
Why though? That doesn't make sense.
yeah, absolutely. So, you know, and I'm not talking about watching Fox News versus CNN. I'm talking about watch the actual footage of the jury as a juror would, and see the evidence and everything else. And it, to me, it was a clear cut case of a very politicized scenario, and the jury got it right. Now, does that mean that he should have been there? That's the age old question. You know, we live in the United States. We have the Second Amendment. We have rights to self-defense. All those things can be argued, and certainly will be. But in this instance, he was, you know, what he said.
I get it.
Lined up, and
I get it. And all that stuff makes sense. And again, I'm not saying that it was wrong. They came to the right decision. Even with the self-defense, totally understand that. But it's just weird. Like, you go to a civil unrest or something else, right? We don't call it riots.
Civil unrest. Yeah,
right, yeah. A civil unrest, and you bring a gun, and then I'm just saying, maybe just don't do that. You have the right to have a weapon. You have the right to be there, and you have the right to defend yourself. Just it's just stupid. That's all. Just don't do it. That's just my opinion. So it looks like Larry has said to donate to another person. So he doesn't want it. That's
randomize again.
No, we'll just go do the next one down, like wherever you went, if you can remember where it was. And I just want to make sure, Larry, please put in the comments if that is what you meant. Because we don't want to give I believe so. And if so, that's freaking awesome, Larry. But we can't keep everybody passing it forward because we're going to run out of show at some point.
So the next one past Larry would be Josh Benjamin.
Josh Benjamin. I got to remember that.
And he's thankful for the city.
He's a happy camper.
What's that, Fitzy?
You know him, Kurt?
No, but I bet he's happy.
Oh. Yeah. what was he thankful for?
A city, county, police, EMS, and firefighters.
Oh, yeah, so right.
But not Dryden Wire. Wow, what a jerk. You guys get all the love.
He said police first. Kurt and I could have a little battle here because he's a
fire. Right, yeah.
Police versus fire, where do we rate?
So. Yeah.
I'll say the best time that.
By the way, hold on a second, Kurt.
Fall has.
Yeah. By the way, there's our shirt designs. We're probably going to go with one on the left. We're making headway. That was a design from Barb. Fuller, is that right, Fitzy?
Yep, Barb Fuller.
And she had her designer make those. The one on the right, I really like a lot. Except the one on the left really pops off of the off of a T-shirt. So I think we're gonna go with that one. What are your thoughts, Kirk? Which shirt do you like better, one on the left or right?
Boy, they both look great. I kind of lean to the one on the right because I like that nostalgic font on there.
Yeah, it looks like a kitchen diner. Or something.
Looks pretty sweet.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, congratulations, Josh. We will get that sent to you as soon as they send it. As soon as we get finished, we will reach out to Josh once again, and just a different Josh, the one who sends us those codes. We will get that to you. Kirk, anything else that you wanted to make sure we talked about that we didn't? Then anything coming up for you this week?
It's Thanksgiving, so I wanted to just say happy Thanksgiving to everyone coming up on Thursday. Be safe as you travel and stay COVID free. It's I'm very thankful for our community and for the opportunity to be on this show. It's funny because you kind of watch all these things and you get to know people like Ben and Fitz, and you feel like you're best friends with them because you listen to them talk every week. Aww. and so it feels like home to just sit and chat with you guys. It's been great.
Well, it was an absolute pleasure for Fitzy.
It was awesome. I appreciate it.
Pleasure for Fitzy. Thanks, Ben.
I'm kidding. Kirk, you are one of my closest friends. I have so much respect for you as a human being.
Give me a cup.
I don't have cups. We can't afford it. We're a free media outlet, dude. Where are these coming from? Where's that revenue?
I thought you had cups.
No, we don't have cups. No, even the one I have now, this one is actually from Fitzy, so get one from him. It's
I would take
sheriff's office there, and then this was thank you. This was the Jamie Kloss. Actually, it's green screened, so that's weird. You can like see through it.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, so that's the one I use. Yeah, we can't afford cups, dude.
We'll have to work on that.
Yeah, Fitzy, what are you doing for Thanksgiving?
Nothing. Just staying home with the family and relaxing and. Gonna be out. I'm gonna ring bells for the Salvation Army tomorrow.
Attaboy.
Do a radio show tomorrow and
really a radio show where?
WGMC.
Yep. Like you're gonna DJ or something or what do they do?
Yeah, I'm gonna spin the records and
spin the records.
I don't know.
Yeah, I'd pay to see that. It's the radio, so you can't watch it.
Yeah.
All right.
What are you up to, Ben?
I'm staying here as long as possible, so I don't have to get put to work for my life. No, I'm just kidding. No, family stuff. We did one this last weekend with one family, and now this Thursday will be at mom and dad's house, and yeah, it'll be a good time. Got my second shot of COVID, of the vaccine. So now I can do whatever I want.
Second shot?
No, just finally the second one. I just, I was a little late to the party on that one. Yeah. Oh, and he's gone. All right, cool. Well, we that's our cue. He just like, well, that's it. I don't even want to be here anymore.
All right, thanks, Ben. Appreciate it. Everybody have a great Thanksgiving.
Yeah, you bet. Well, hold on. He's back. I'll just put him back on there. All right, so we're already finished, Kirk. You've been watching Positive Tuesday with Ben and Fitzy, presented by ICAA. ICAA is your local social service organization that works together with individuals, families, and the community to create and support local solutions for local needs. Is that why you've been moving your head back and forth, Fitzy, because of the sun? You're trying to block it? I'm like, why is he always turning? I see you down.
No, I'm playing with my phone, too. I'm trying to get the comments.
Okay. For a full list of services about ICA, find them on Facebook or check them out on their website, IndianHeadCAA.org. Special thank you to our guest today, firefighter and first responder on the St. Croix Falls Fire Department and mayor of the city of St. Croix Falls, Kirk Anderson. For Barron County Sheriff Chris Fitzgerald, I'm Ben Dren saying thank you for watching. Thank you, everyone, for commenting. We'll see you next week where we do another giveaway of a 4-pack of tickets for the Miracle at Big Rock. So until then, stay safe, stay positive, and as always, have a blessed day.